not toiled for it. This too is meaningless and a great misfortune. What do people get for all the toil and anxious striving with which they labor under the sun? All their days, their work is grief and pain. Even at night, their minds do not rest. This too is meaningless. The second reading is from Colossians chapter 3, verses 1 through 11, and can be found on page 1834 of the Pew Bible. Colossians 3, 1 through 11. Since, then, you have raised with Christ, set your hearts on things above, where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things above, not on earthly things. For you died, and your life is now hidden with Christ in God. When Christ was in your life appears, then you also appear with him in glory. Put to death, therefore, whatever belongs to your earthly nature, sexual immorality, impurity, lust, evil desires, and greed, which is idolatry. Because of these, the wrath of God is coming. You used to walk in these ways in the life you once lived, but now you must also rid yourself of all things, as these anger, rage, malice, slander, and filthy language from your lips. Do not lie to each other, since you have taken off your old self with its practices and have put on the new self, which is being renewed in knowledge in the image of its creator. Here there is no Gentile or Jew, circumcised or uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave or free, but Christ is all and is in all. This is the reading of the Lord.
Gospel according to Luke, the 12th chapter. Someone in the crowd said to him, "Teacher, tell my brother to divide the inheritance with me." Jesus replied, "Man, who appointed me a judge or an arbiter between you?" Then he said to them, "Watch out. Be on your guard against all kinds of greed. Life does not consist in an abundance of possessions." And he told them this parable. The ground of a certain rich man yielded an abundant harvest. He thought to himself, "What shall I do? I have no place to store my crops." Then he said, "This is what I'll do. I will tear down my barns and build bigger ones, and there I will store my surplus grain. And I'll say to myself, 'You have plenty of grain laid up for many of years. Take life easy. Eat, drink, and be merry.'" But God said to him, "You fool, this very night your life will be demanded of you. Then who will get what you have prepared for yourself? This is how it will be with whoever stores up things for themselves, but is not rich toward God." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated. From what I saw in the news headlines this weekend, a single ticket, just won the Mega Millions lottery. Something like $1.3 billion, give or take a few, you know, tens of billions. Tens of millions. From what I understand, however, these massive lottery payouts don't always improve people's lives the way you might think. Lottery winners report losing friends. They're usually flooded with scams. And I think more than half have spent all of their money, regardless of the size of the payout, within about 5 years. Now, who knows if the winner, because as far as I know, the winner has not come forward yet, who knows if the winner will be in church this morning to hear Jesus tell this story? But in a way, the rich fool kind of won the first century lottery with his bumper crop. Eat, drink, and be merry is his response. This is what the landowner says in our parable. He's taken a look at the balance in his 401k, and he figures he is set. He's ready to put his feet up and relax. Eat, drink, and be merry, he says. But we know this proverb. What is the next line? Anyone in the audience? For tomorrow we die. It's rather bleak, actually. I think we think of this as a Greek proverb, but it has its origins in Isaiah. It's part of an oracle regarding the foolishness of relying only on earthly powers for the defense of the city. Eat, drink, and be merry, says the landowner. He has enough surplus grain to provide an income for many years. It's not really a mistake for him to provide for his future. It's a mistake to assume that by his wealth he can secure his future. Because as God shows up at the end of this parable, tomorrow he will die. But looking at the landowner, I wonder whether he really had it in him to eat, drink, and be merry anyway. Who exactly is he going to be merry with? Because if you look at this reading, every pronoun that the landowner uses is in the singular. It is I, or it is my. What should I do to store my crops? I will build bigger barns. When he's making plans to eat, drink, and be merry, the only person he's talking to is himself. He sounds less like someone planning a party and more like someone begging the bartender for one more round because he can't stand to go home alone at closing time. Now, we don't know if this landowner in the story has always been like this or if this bumper crop has flipped some sort of greed switch in his heart, but there are several other clues to his kind of unhealthy relationship with wealth in this monologue. First off, out of the gate, he shows no gratitude for this bonanza, no gratitude to God. The ground produced the abundant harvest. He did not. He did not make this happen all by himself. The sun and the rain are the provision of God, and the landowner has missed his chance, a chance most farmers I know take every time they can. He's missed his chance to express his thanks to God for all he has been given, especially this harvest. Second, he shows no gratitude to the workers who must have helped him plant and tend and gather this harvest. In fact, I'm guessing they had to work overtime to bring in this larger than usual crop. And there was no one making sure that the hired help got paid time and a half back in the first century. He didn't bring this harvest in all on his own, yet he intends to be the only one to substantially benefit from it. And also, he makes no provision for the poor from his bounty, which a good Jewish landowner owner would have in the day. Quite the contrary, by storing it all up so that he can sell it when it benefits him the most, he's keeping the price of the grain high. He could have used his abundance to benefit his neighbors, but he doesn't. And it is only the specter of death itself that puts his wealth in perspective. All the grain and all the barns and all the world cannot save his life on this night. All the grain and all the barns and all the world has not made him rich toward God. Now, I know we're at the end of July, but as I'm reading this story, with the rich man's wealth and his isolation, he reminded me of no one else more than Ebenezer Scrooge from A Christmas Carol. The only difference is that from the telling of the Scrooge story that I'm familiar with, Scrooge didn't even use his wealth to make himself merry, let alone anybody else. But Scrooge and the rich fool are both isolated, lonely men, only concerned with their business. They only realize that their wealth cannot save them when they are faced with their own death. The rich fool doesn't get a chance to reform his ways, but Scrooge sees his death in a dream, a vision, a visitation, I don't know how you want to interpret that, thanks to his one and only friend, Marley, which I think ties in with Pastor Mike's theme of friendship. It's good to have friends. Scrooge sees that his wealth won't save him, and he is given the opportunity to reform his life, and he takes it. Now, I'm assuming you're all familiar with this story. It's been around for over 100 years. My personal favorite is the George C. Scott version, George C. Scott as Scrooge, from the mid-80s. But looking at Scrooge through the lens of our parable, I think Scrooge's reformation also gives us some clues to what it can mean to be rich towards God, since we don't get any definition of that from the parable itself. To begin with, Scrooge gives up being alone. You see him eating his terrible little soup in his cold little room. But he repairs his relationship with his nephew, and he joins Fred and his wife for Christmas for the first time after years and years and years of rebuffed invitation. Now, this doesn't actually threaten his wealth at all. Going to Fred's house for Christmas dinner does not cost him anything except maybe his pride. And he accepts with humility that he needs this relationship in his life. And also, Scrooge begins to use his wealth for someone else's benefit, or for someone's benefit, because as we said, he hardly even used it for himself. He gives generously to charity when just the day before he had declared that those who would rather die than go to the poorhouse had better do so and decrease the surplus population. He admits that his donation has many back payments, but also asks the men collecting to come round later so he can arrange regular support. And perhaps most notable, the thing anyone would know, even if they're not, don't watch Scrooge every Christmas like I do, is he becomes a better employer. He doubles Cratchit's salary and sends his family the prize Christmas turkey on Christmas morning. And in a change that sounds really contemporary, he pays for Tiny Tim's health care so that the sickly boy is allowed to grow and thrive. So Scrooge gets the chance to use his wealth and to benefit the poor and his employee in a way that the rich fool in the parable never did. And Scrooge also regains his family in the process. His wealth draws him towards others at the end of the story, not away from them. That, plus gratitude, which we noted the rich fool is missing, it's not quite expressed in Dickens's story and per se, is at least the beginnings of being rich toward God, the way the parable urges us to be. Now, if we are waiting for a vision of our own death to shake up our relationship with money, we may be like the rich fool, and we may be too late. But the truth is, we have already had an encounter with death that frees us from putting our trust in wealth in ways that isolate us from the world around us. In our reading from Colossians, we are reminded that in our baptism, we have all died in Christ. Our lives are already in God. Now, when was hearing that you had already died sounded like good news? But it is. We have put on a new self and are being renewed over and over again in the image of our Creator. My internship supervisor used to use a phrase like this every other sermon, I think. In our baptism, we are dead, buried, and out of the way. So we are free to serve our neighbor, or in this case, free to use the wealth we have, whether it is much, whether it is Mega Millions, whether it is Scrooge wealth, or whether it is small, to uphold community and to draw us into deeper relationship with the world around us, rather than to use that wealth to isolate ourselves and protect us from the world around us. So Jesus is addressing a young man. I'm guessing it's the younger brother, because if it was the older brother, he could divide the inheritance however he wanted. Jesus tells this story to this young man who has asked for his help to get the fair share of inheritance. Perhaps what Jesus sees is that this man's question already displays ways that he is choosing riches over relationships. He may be on his way to becoming Ebenezer Scrooge. He might think that by getting his share of the inheritance, he will be able to eat, drink, and be merry. But who will he celebrate with if he's alienated his brother in the course of dividing the inheritance? Now, unless somebody went to Illinois to buy that ticket, I'm assuming we don't have the billions of the Mega Millions winner. But we would still do well to heed this parable of the rich fool. Do we use our money in ways that draw us towards other people and towards trusting in God? Or does our money insulate and isolate us from others? Are we generous in our business practices and in our charity? We can eat, drink, and be merry because we have already died in Christ. We don't need our money to save us, so we can use it for the benefit of others as well as ourselves. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Thank you. Let us confess our faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, of all that is his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God whose steadfast love endures forever. Amen. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. You're invited to sit or to kneel. Merciful God, we confess that we have not followed your path, but have chosen our own way. Instead of putting others before ourselves, we long to take the best seats at the table. When met by those in need, we have too often passed by on the other side. Set us again on the path of life, save us from ourselves, and free us to love our neighbors. Amen. Please stand. Hear the good news. God does not deal with us according to our sins, but delights in granting pardon and mercy. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. You are free to love as God loves. Amen.
To the Lord our God.
It is indeed right and salutary that we should at all times and in all places offer thanks and praise to you, O Lord, Holy Father, through Christ our Lord, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. The night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, broke it, gave thanks, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Again after supper, he took the cup, he gave thanks, He gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." We praise the Lord has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Friends, come, the feast is prepared. Please be seated. Please rise. The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. Trusting in God's extraordinary love, let us come near to the Holy One in prayer. O God, you are wholeness. Where there is division in your church, bring reconciliation and healing. Guide the work of theologians, teachers, seminary professors, life group leaders, and all who provide instruction and leadership for the building up of your church. Merciful God, receive our prayer. O God, you are the source of life. Bless farmers, ranchers, distributors, and all who provide food. Nourish the land and its inhabitants. Merciful God, receive our prayer. O God, you are wisdom. Where nations and communities yearn for peace, bring justice. Strengthen those who toil for the welfare of others, especially military personnel, police, firefighters, and first responders. Merciful God, receive our prayer. O God, you are life. Where your people are overwhelmed with the busyness of life, bring encouragement. Accompany all who are experiencing emotional, mental, or physical distress. We pray especially this morning for Judy Garvin, for Chris, Emily and JD, Ruth, Annie Buss, Terry Haley, Jane Hunt, Christine Hutt, Earl Osborne, Tori Mullinex, Rick Scott, Charlotte Seacrest, and Tammy Weiss. Renew us and refresh us with your mercy. Merciful God, receive our prayer. O God, you are our treasure. Where scarcity and anxiety pervade your church, bring abundance and vitality. Guide the work of our church council, staff, and other committees that they might have clarity and inspiration for the work of ministry at St. Luke. Merciful God, receive our prayer. Receive the prayers of your children, merciful God, and hold us forever in your steadfast love through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Please be seated. So a couple announcements this morning. First, there's a connection card. Please make sure you fill it out. It'll be online or in person here. We appreciate that. There's ways to be involved in the back of that. A couple of highlights, health and school kits. We're collecting items for those. You may have noticed the white boxes. There's a white box in the narthex, then also down the hallway. We're collecting donations for the school and health kits for Lutheran World Relief. And we're collecting different items every week. This upcoming week, we need nail clippers and crayons. So you can use the donation schedule printed in your bulletin, or use the Amazon wish list listed in your bulletin, or on the website stlukecolumbus.com. Our mission project for Vacation Bible School with the ELCA is continuing. Today is the last day to give, and we're grateful for the generous, loving gifts that have been given so far. And we make a difference through ELCA Good Gifts, which is your opportunity to provide critical support to the ministries and programs that mean the most to you and people you love. There's a QR code in your bulletin to give that. Basically, you're purchasing livestock for people in other parts of the world that they can't provide on their own. And a couple quick things about how to, you know, if you want to stay connected with folks, and just deepen relationship. We have relationships with people here. We have two opportunities. We have St. Luke Hang coming up on Saturday, August 13th. Myself and Greg Osborne, we're going to be at Heart State Brewing over in Gahanna. So if you want to join us that night at 7 p.m., it's a Saturday night, you're welcome to come and have a cold beverage with us and just hang out. We'd love to see you. And then also, we have Picnic in the Park coming up August 21st. And so we're going to do that with International Christian Center, and it's going to be at 1:30 or 2. I'm not sure exactly the time, but it's going to be early in the afternoon. And it's going to be a potluck in a sense that people, you'll just bring food. We'll have a cornhole tournament. It's going to be a great opportunity to share some time with friends here, but also make some new friends with International Christian Center. It's going to be a great event. August 21st, that's at Hannah Park on that Sunday afternoon. Okay? Those are the announcements I have. There's a lot more in your bulletin, certainly online, in the email newsletter, and so on. Please stand as we conclude worship with our blessing and our last hymn. May the peace of the Lord Christ go with you wherever he may send you. May he guide you through the wilderness and protect you through the storm. May he bring you home rejoicing at the wonders he has shown you once again into our doors. Amen. Peace, love your neighbor.
Thanks be.